Good evening, good evening, good evening. Welcome, welcome, welcome to everyone to Empowerment Liberation Cathedral, better known as ELC. This is our Women's History Month, and we have someone phenomenal that will be coming on tonight. But first, I need you all to hit like. I need you to hit share. I need for everybody to create a watch party. This is watch party worthy on tonight. We have a phenomenal woman on tonight. Can any of y'all hear our famous poet saying phenomenal woman? All right, so Maya Angelou would have said this about our guest on tonight, but I need y'all to hit like, I need you to hit share, and I need you to create a watch party. I need everybody creating watch parties because all of your friends need to be able to see who you're going to see tonight. All of your family members need to see who you're going to see tonight. And your coworkers, anybody you know, folks in the neighborhood, they need to see who you're going to see tonight. So I need you to take a moment to hit like. I'm hitting like right now. And to create a watch party, okay? So everybody create watch parties with me. And I need for everybody to hit like and share. Now, if you have friends that you know are not on Facebook, you can tell them to join us on YouTube at Empowerment Liberation Cathedral. They can join us on YouTube at Empowerment Liberation Cathedral. Also, if you have friends that are not on YouTube, but they have a Roku TV, tell them they can find us at Empowerment Lib Cathedral. All right, so they can find us almost anywhere. And if all they do is internet, they can go on empowermentliberationcathedral.org, the church's website. Hey, how about that? They can go there and click on watch now, and they can see tonight's special guest for our Women's History Month. And we're gonna have a great, great conversation on tonight. All right, so I need, once again, for everybody to hit like, everybody to hit share, and everybody to create a watch party. So once you do that, I think I'll be able to see that on my screen, and we will know that you all have joined us and that you are inviting all of your friends to join us, okay? So we have none other than the legendary Sarah Dash, who is going to join us in a few moments. But first, I want to read a couple of things to you about her while you are getting your friends to watch along with us. All right. So Sarah Dash was born in Trenton, New Jersey. Any New Jersey folks on tonight? If not, y'all get them on here. Get them on here. All right. She is a daughter of the late elder Abraham Dash and the late mother Elizabeth Dash. She is the seventh child of 13. So by the age of seven, music was already an integral part of Sarah's life. Let's see, Sarah was baptized at the Trenton Church of Christ when she was 13 years old. Sarah continues her studies of various religions and serves as the family's chaplain. Isn't that nice to be the family chaplain? That is wonderful. She counsels and speaks to women's groups and churches all over the country, as well as the youth and at-risk facilities. She's a tireless advocate for homeless women with children. Sarah's illustrious career includes recording and performing live with some of the greatest names in the industry. Rolling Stones, any of y'all old enough to remember them? I know we got some millennials that may not know who those people are. Alice Cooper, the OJs. Some of y'all know the OJs. If not, go Google them. That's what everybody does today. They Google everybody. Bo Diddley. She toured with her good friend Keith Richards and the Expensive Winos. Sarah appeared on Richards' latest CD, Cross-Eyed Heart, in addition to writing songs with Richards and Steve Jordan. She recently appeared with both of those at the Apollo Theater for the Jazz Foundation of America salute to singer Mary Clayton. Sarah's a songwriter. She's an actress, a producer, also known for her disco dance music classic, Center Man, Low Down Dirty Rhythm. Some of y'all need to listen to that tonight. All right, Sarah has channeled her talent, wisdom, and knowledge of the music industry into many consulting opportunities, vocal coaching for new and established artists. And let me say for certain bishops too. So after giving an informal seminar at the College of New Jersey, the school approached Sarah to help professors create and develop the course, Trenton Makes Music, for which Sarah now serves as podcast host, consultant, and guest lecturer. Sarah is the first music and arts ambassador for Trenton, New Jersey, position that currently holds, served for 8 years on the Grammy Board of Governors, is a Grammy New Jersey ambassador for the Advocacy Board of the Membership Committee, serves on the Board of the Trustees for New Jersey Capitol Philharmonic, a longstanding member of the Recording Academy, and is a member of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, music and art administrator at Sprout University School of the Arts. So, Sarah, as many of you know, is a founding member of Patti LaBelle and the Bluebells, along with Patti LaBelle, Nona Hendrix, and Cindy Birdsong, who later joined the Supremes. Patti LaBelle and the Bluebells, later becoming LaBelle, became one of 1970s groundbreaking funk bands. LaBelle's international hit, Lady Marmalade, was produced by the legendary, the late Alan Toussaint. LaBelle was known for their outrageous stage costumes. Can y'all see Sarah Dash in one of those costumes? High energy shows and epic stage production. LaBelle made history as the first and only African-American female group to take a production to the Metropolitan Opera House in New York City, as well as other major theaters and opera houses around the world with their show, Wear Something Silver. LaBelle has received several gold albums before the group broke up. Sarah began an eclectic music career, was inducted into the Rhythm and Blues Foundation's Hall of Fame in 1999. So after we show this short video, we will see and begin to talk with none other than Sarah Dash. Yeah. All right. And so now we are going to ask if Sarah Dash will open her mic and greet us on tonight.
Okay. Good evening, everyone.
We're so happy to have you with us on tonight. Also, we have joining us, we have Deacon Sylvester Stokes, and we have Deacon Kim Hall, who is joining us on tonight. Well, I tell you, even if you're in the church, even if you say sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, you got to move on that song. That's all I can tell you. It makes you move. I don't care who you are. So, we wanted to just show everyone that, just to see the outfits and see, you know, a little bit of what y'all did a long time ago, and some people are still doing now. So I want to start out by asking you, what was your childhood dream? Let's start there. What did you want to be as a young person?
As a young teenager, I'd say as soon as I turned 13, I always thought I'd have a white apron, a husband, and about 17 kids making dinner for them. And that, you know, the American dream that you saw, you know, with the car commercials and things, I could be that. And then later I was given household duties to do, and I had to get through them, like washing the dishes, and I needed to make up songs while I was doing that. And then all of a sudden I realized I'm singing like I'm singing in the church, and I'm making up songs. So it was that. And then as I got into high school and created the rock and roll, you know, little girl groups, teenage groups rather, it got to be, okay, do I go to college or do I opt for show business? Bearing in mind that Dad was a Pentecostal preacher. So my dreams were to be in the music industry, to make a long story short.
All right. All right. Well, you know, it's interesting when you said the 17 kids. I'm like, oh, Lord.
Well, my mother had 13, so.
Yeah. So, you know, that's interesting that you were making up songs while you were cleaning, because I'm sure maybe somebody was watching can say, hey, they were doing some things and maybe, you know, coming up with songs or making up little jingles or, you know, coming up with words that could be the words of somebody else's songs. So yes. I want to encourage somebody to not give up on those things that you write while doing domestics.
Okay? That's true.
And so now, was any one of those songs that you wrote, one of them that we heard at any point later?
Yes, Patti LaBelle and the Bluebells recorded Loving Rules. You know, once in my life, I loved the man. He said he loved me, but he was playing me for a fool. That sounds very teenage. But the Philadelphia International trio, you know, the basic people at the time I was married, and my husband was the band leader for the Up Down Theater. And so they produced the song. And it swings, you know, but you could tell it was a young person writing it.
Yeah.
But to hear my sister say my chores consisted of, and I'll tell you, once a week I had to dry the dishes. And on Saturdays I had to scrub down the banister coming down the stairs and dust off the steps. And it took me all day because I had an excuse for everything. So it took me. They were mopping floors, and, you know, and I had that one thing to shine, you know, the mahogany, and that was my chore.
And I think it's always enlightening to hear somebody else's view of what you had to do. So yes. They always keep you with a level head.
Yes, it does.
Yeah, and I think that's important because, you know, we may remember as we had a lot to do, and they're like, what? Girl, you didn't have nothing to do. You were doing this, and while we did 20 other things, you know. So I think that is good that your sister reminded you of what your chores were.
Yeah, they keep me grounded to a point.
Yes, that's good. So now you started singing, I assume, as most people in the church. And then when did they know that you had something significant or something special?
Well, without my father knowing, I won a
Uh-oh.
contest, singing with the group that I created, the Del Capris. We love the Dells and we love the Capris. So people who don't know who they are, like Bishop said, research, research. And I won a contest singing, and the prize was to sing at a nightclub. In the meantime, we acquired a manager at that time. We made a big $10, and I think we spent $50 on our outfit. And some of the church members' children who were not in the church was at this club in New Jersey called the Crossing Inn, and they went back and reported and told on me. So my dad was out of
Uh-oh.
town, and I went to church and attempted to stand up and sing in the choir. And one of the church members, one of the mothers of the church, she pulled me outside and shook me, and she's like, "How dare you? Da 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 da! And you're kicked out of the choir, and you're and so." In the meantime, I'm thinking my dad supported this and I wouldn't talk to him. And in the meantime, there was a big family discussion. What is she calling herself doing? I was all of 15 and was always a grade ahead. So I was always I had a lot of older friends. But my oldest sister and my mother said to my dad, "You've got to let her do this." My mother knew I had to do. And my sister said, "She'll stay with me until you get over this, Dad." And that's what I did. So it was very hard. My father did not see us ever until the Metropolitan Opera House. That was the first time he saw us. And Nona and Patty were saying, "Oh, you couldn't come to any of the crawling places when we were singing on the back of the buses and trucks. You had to come to the elegant place." And he was we were the last people to leave the party. I was the last person. My father had to meet everyone. And I have a picture, the only picture that night with that was taken of the parents was with my parents. My mother's on my left, my dad's on my right, and I have a glass of champagne holding it up, toasting it. That wonderful night. Yes. So that it's on my piano and it encourages me. Because I had the love, you know. But, you know, religion, you know how that goes, Bishop. You raise
I can see that's
church.
going to take you now.
Well, it really did take an effect because my mother and father never had to get me out of rehab or jail. So, and not to say that I didn't go to the fair now. I'm not
Yes,
saying I, you know, but I didn't stay too long. She
ma'am.
stayed at the fair too long. No, I came home. I got off that ride. And there are things that I'm not always proud of everything I've done, but it's a growing process. And as a result, I'm here today. And it's not to damage or say anything negative to people who've had that experience in jail or rehab. I think it's wonderful when you can cross those roads and see that you have a much more beautiful life than the life that certain things take the path that they'll take you down. So I support all those people, you know. So don't you all call the bishops and say who does she think she is? Think she's cute because she there's some other things I've done that you probably never done. So yes.
Wow. I'm going to ask you one other question, then we'll hear and see if anybody else has a question. But how did you get connected moving from the Del Capri's and all the places where you probably sang with your groups? How did you get connected with Patti LaBelle and form that particular group?
Patty's, we had the same manager, our teenage groups. And some of the people from Patty's group left, and some from my group left. And the manager put us together. But when I saw Patty's group was called the Ordettes, I always thought they were like 40 years old. Because now, mind you, we're singing in sweaters and pleated skirts and little cubby heels. And here comes the Ordettes. They have our how do you call it? Tiaras, you know,
Oh,
like the little
Tiaras.
tiaras and low cut dresses and slits up the hair and high heels about 7 inches long. And I'm like, wow, they're so great. And here we come from Trenton, New Jersey, red sweaters and black pants. And because we had two guys in our group too. And we had black pleated skirts. So we looked up to the Ordettes. And the one time we were able to actually wear evening dresses, it was such a wonder to break that pattern. But we had the same manager, and he put us together. And Cindy and Patty were in the Ordettes. Nona and I came from the Del Capris. We used to make a joke and tell everybody we met at Howard Johnson's on the Turnpike, but we soon left that alone. Yes.
Wow, wow. That's amazing that you all had the same manager.
Yes.
So that kind of makes you feel like they didn't have a whole lot of groups back then. About how many groups did one manager was allowed to have?
Well, he had us as teenagers, the Ordettes and Adele Capris, and he had a few solo artists. His nephew, who was a very good singer, came to a club in Trenton, and one of the girls in my group, her mother worked as a barmaid in the club, and she told Mr. Montague about her daughter's group, and that's how we got to meet him. He auditioned us, and that's, you know, and he'd already had the Ordettes, but we slammed it out, you know. And our top song we're singing back then was Mr. Postman.
Oh, you know?
Yes, yes.
Okay, all
yeah.
right.
Well, yeah, that was our audition piece.
Wow, I'm sure you slammed that. Wow. Well, that's interesting to know. Interesting to know. What we're going to hear, does Deacon Sylvester, Deacon Kim, and now we have Minister Cat. Any of you have any questions for the legendary Sarah Dash?
Well, I have a comment and a question. Okay. So that video that you showed just before we came on, I only just saw that video maybe a couple of months ago. Yeah. I was on YouTube and I had my ear, you know, my earbuds, and I wasn't necessarily looking at the screen, but the song came on and I just let it play. And then I started looking at it when it was almost over, and I was like, wait, hold on. I said, wait, I was looking at that outfit you were wearing. I was like, she is wearing that outfit and the moves. And so I had to watch it again because I had missed half of it. So then it got me to thinking, you know, you guys were performing in some, it was probably like a small club or something. But what was it like back then when you guys were performing in, you mostly performing in front of live audiences and places like the Apollo? What was it like when you were always performing in front of live audiences?
It's a feeling that it's exhilarating, really, because you get in each place, you get a different kind of response. When we were in Europe, they were sort of more reserved. That clip that you saw was a television show that we were doing in Europe from that particular clip. And you know, the people stood up when we walked out. And if you sort of study the background, because I've been studying all of our old clips due to the fact that I'm writing a book. So I've been studying and remembering times. But it's a feeling of audience response sometimes, you know, live with our band. We would bring people up who thought they could be a Lady Marmalade or a Joe and get them to dance. And Deacon Sylvester knows about that. And, you know, so we would always include the audience in one part of the show. And it just gave them a feeling of, you know, call and response. And it didn't matter what ethnicity you were, what your preferences were. I always related to LaBelle as the group that bridged the gap, because we had all types of people on the stage and following us. We did not discriminate. And that was a result of our live performance.
Wow.
Was there another? Oh, and let me tell you something. When I look at that body in that video, waistline gone. Gone. Well, but you know, life is still here, and that's the beautiful part about it, you know.
Right. And you're absolutely yes. right, Aunt Sarah. We go way back. I think I saw you first when I was 17.
Yes.
What I admire about you is that your personality, your love for people hasn't changed throughout the years.
Thank you.
I could really sit and this could be a Sarah and Sylvester show, ELC show right now. But that's how grounded you are. And you were talking about your sisters keeping you grounded. You don't need anybody to keep you grounded because I know that you're a child of God. And I know that you, from our conversations, that you're definitely going to support. And what I could tell you about the first concert that I attended.
Yes.
I was a little 17-year-old person and I came backstage. Probably shouldn't have even been back there. And you
He's
were just
open. He slipped
exactly,
through.
Exactly. Yes. And so I look at that and it kind of reminds me of that behavior, that attachment to young folks. And not that you were that much older, but reminds me of our culture in terms of support, in terms of sharing the love, in terms of kind of guiding and helping people see the light. And so when you said that, you know, concerts, the beauty of the concert was being able to bridge the gap, I experienced that. Yes. And so I wanted to say thank you. I wanted to welcome you specifically again to ELC, but I wanted to say thank you for always having that experience where I feel like not just a fan, but a true brother to you.
And so you are indeed, Sylvester. As Deacon and Bishops know that, Sylvester's been in my life, for like 50 years or something? I mean, it's been a very long time. We have been maturing together. And we get on the phone, we have to make appointments simply because, you know, what do you have to do? Is Thursday okay? Is Friday? But Sylvester has watched us come from LaBelle into solo, Patti LaBelle and the Bluebells, LaBelle, and into solo artist. And he has supported me. I love his support. He would come from DC to New York and then turn around and go back to DC. Says, girl, I have to work tomorrow. And I'm like, what? You're not staying over, you know? But that kind of support has brought us to where we are, you know, me being mother of your church, which is, you know, the whole aspect of this is that knowing that music, no matter how the wheel spins, it's God's gift. And you always say, you know, girl, you have a gift. And then he watched me go through an accident where I couldn't walk for 4 years. Sylvester was still there, loving me in spite of. I had the cane. I was walking. Always Sylvester. I'm in D.C. getting my treatments because I had to go to specialized doctors to get surgery. So I moved to D.C. and Sylvester was always there, always there. And I just love you so much. And, you know, and now I've fallen in love with your bishop, too. So it's and the church, you know, we have wonderful, wonderful conversations with her. I'm sure sometimes I go off the deep end and she just listens. She said, well, thank you for filling me in. You know? But Sylvester, you have been there. I wondered, what questions would you ask me knowing me for so long, you know?
I want to know, I would like for you to share what your thoughts are in terms of this, the society that we're in terms of injustice, in terms of what we're going through with the pandemic.
Yes.
We can even classify the injustice that we see with brown people, black and brown people as a pandemic. What are your thoughts and what are your guiding words for us?
Well, I must say firsthand, it was quite disturbing to experience Floyd's death and to see that hatred actually in our faces. It took something out of my gut to see that the blatant behavior of one who is hired and paid for by us to protect us that could commit murder in front of the world. It was quite disturbing. I started reading the 91st Psalm all the time. The 37th Psalm had always been something that my dad had given me, "Fret not thyself because of evildoers," you know. And I had to go scripture, spiritual on that, just to see the atrocities that were committed beyond that. And for us to have to say BLM, Black Lives Matter, don't they know we matter? I mean, we built those very houses that they live in DC. Slaves built that. And to see the beauty of that, I just urge everyone who is any of any color to go visit the White House, look at the structure, go inside the Capitol building, look at the amazing artwork, look at the talent that we had. Even being enslaved, we were able to create something that has lasted for years. So to see all that, and I've been in the Capitol building many times because of being a governor for the Grammys. We have something called Grammy on the Hill, where we go and we speak to the senators and the congresspeople about the bills that we need change for artists, you know, everywhere, you know, not just in America, but everywhere. But those bills have to start with us. But to see that work, there's not a wooden, not a staircase in the Capitol building that's wood. It's all marble, everything. So you can imagine the crying and the slave songs and the songs that got them through. So today it affects me in a sense that the only thing I can do is keep saying affirmations, encouraging young people, my family members, coaching them. When people come to me, and I've had many folks come to me and said, "Well, how do you maintain your spirituality?" It's not me alone. I'm telling you, Most High grabs you when you really are faithful, and you will obey that small voice. So I'm not happy about it. And then the other thing is the COVID. May I go there with the COVID shot? There are some of us who have taken it. And ladies, let me say this to you. Ladies everywhere, black, green, purple, whoever you are, when you get that shot, be careful, because there's the lymph nodes will swell, and you must really pay attention to how that affects you. It may be diagnosed as something else, but pay attention to your body when you have that. If you're left-handed, get it done in your right arm. If you're right-handed, get it done in your left arm. Switch up, because. But today, I'm not very happy, but thank God we got that orange person out of the White House. Okay, we removed that monster, because he was taking us down a path. Anytime you encourage people to go in and destroy the Capitol building, it's something screwy up there. I could say other words, but my Peter spirit, I will not let it take over today. And y'all know that Peter cussed in the Bible. So I'm not going to let my Peter spirit come upon me. Okay.
I'm going to have to use that next time I hear somebody cussing, like Kirk Franklin.
Those yes, guys read the story, his Peter spirit.
His yes. Peter spirit came out. Come on came now, down mother. On him.
And we're Peter all of the spirit. One. We're all of the one. So you know it happened. I've heard pastors go there and I say, you know, it's his Peter spirit. You have to be forgiven. He did follow Jesus. So, you know, not a spirit.
I love that. Love that. Love that. Don't y'all use that as no excuse. Those people who are watching. Yes. Start doing stuff and say, that's my Peter spirit. Okay. So I have a couple more questions, but I'm going to ask two, and then I'm going to get back and see if anybody has anything else. Okay. So what was it like being a solo artist after you left the groups and went out on your own? What yeah. was it like being a solo artist?
Well, I was very fortunate to have, I don't know if you remember Don Kirshner's rock concert. Don Kirshner, the television impresario. Anyway, you know what I'm saying. I was the last person in the group to get signed. I was rushed into the studio to do some demos. They were horrible. I was not given the time to develop as a solo artist. The management that I had at the time did not see that there had to be a transformation of musical stretching. If you're used to singing only a few songs that you had a little bit of a verse to lead, being a lead singer has to have, coming from background singing to being a lead singer, it takes time. So Don Kirshner signed me after maybe 8 or 9 months of the group being separated, but he kept me rehearsing me 4 or 5 months before I did my first album, which is the song where Center Man came. I recorded Center Man in one take. That's how much I knew my music. And his writers, his team, they groomed me. Otherwise, and I was doing, which Sylvester saw me, at some little cabaret clubs, but I didn't really know what I was doing. I was floating through the motions, scared, unsure. Sometimes I forgot the words and made them up and people never knew it, but it was, it took a lot of prayer. My father said to me, he was living at the time, he said, before you get out there, because he said, the way you dress could be misconstrued in your personality. I want you to always pray before you make a step. And he said, if you need some money, I'm not exactly poor, he said. And this is what he told me. I wish he was here to give it to me now. But he said, I got about $60,000 I can give you to if you need it. And I was like, oh, my God. And, you know, back in the 70s, $60,000 was a lot. That was happening. But yeah. I told him, I said, I'm going to move on faith. And when Center Man came out, I did a lot of television, all due to Don Kirshner's impressive behavior in the TV land. So I owe my jumpstart of my true jumpstart as a solo artist to Don Kirshner's training, him and his writers. Yeah.
Wow, amazing. So also I'm hearing that it's okay to be nervous. It's okay to be scared. It's okay to feel like you don't really know what you're doing, as long as you have some people around you who know what they're doing.
It does help to have a team, one that is supportive. And you will find as an artist from time to time, that will change. Some people can take you to a certain place and then they have to let go. But, you know, God has blessed me because I, as a solo artist, I've had 2 managers during my 40 year. And right now, everything is based upon Team Dash. I have 4 people. We have a stylist, Darius Baptist, my makeup artist, Baynard Giles. We have Marvin Johnson, who we go back and forth all the time. In fact, we have moments where I said, that's because you love me. That's why you put up with me. My sister, who is my personal assistant, my nephew who comes and goes, we never know when he's going to show up. But and Sylvester knows
that's Baltimore nephew, right? That's my Baltimore nephew. Is that him?
Yes. No, my Baltimore nephew, he really helps me with the social media. That's Boogie. Okay. Well, he thinks he's bougie. We call him Bougie Bobby because he is one of, high end, but very, very stable in his his artistic direction. They all contribute to my artistic value. Bougie has his own skin line company now. And, he's switching back and forth between me and what he's developing. I also have a skin line company too, that because of the pandemic, my shelf life has been extended for 1.5 years versus 3 months, But it's called Just a Dash. But that's my team. And they're the ones that, before I sat down tonight, I sent my sister a picture. I said, okay, tell me what this is. Because of the pandemic, I'm doing a lot of virtual. I'm left to my own makeup devices. Now I, you know, got to follow my lip line, little simple things like that, you know, where people expect you to be a certain place in a certain place, even during this time. Well, I don't want to let them down. So I work very hard to keep that encouragement and support coming, because you're encouraging people when you dress up. You really do.
You do. You really do. I like the Baptist guy, the stylist, Mr. Baptist.
Yeah.
I like that.
Everything that I do, I mean, I'm sitting here tonight. Sarah, you know, put this on, put that on. He told me to put on a turban tonight, but I couldn't get it right, so I put this on.
Well, we like what you have on. We love what you have on. So
thank you so much.
So tell him that the bishop was in agreement with what you did.
Just okay, I will. I will indeed. I will. Yes. And,
what caused you to have a passion for helping homeless women, for being an advocate for homeless women?
It comes from my father. We would come home sometimes, and I remember one time in particular, I came in the house, running upstairs. My mom said, "You don't have your bedrooms on the third floor. Your father brought home some people that got put out of their house." And I'm going, "What?" She said, "I took your mattresses. You're going to," I'm like, "What?" You know? And they taught us, it's strangers in the house, but my father knew them, because my dad not only was a pastor, he had real estate holdings. He was also one of the first Black scrap and metal people in the business in the city of Trenton. So therefore, his relationships with people, gays came to our house. In fact, our first babysitter was called Donald the Fox. And my mother would, Donald the Fox would be walking down the street. Mom said, "Donald, I got to go downtown. I want you to watch my girls till I come back." My mom would come back and Donald the Fox would have our hair, because we had a lot of hair, in crazy hairstyles. My mother go, "Okay, well, all right." You know, Donald the Fox became a minister and ran a church during his latter years. So we had people who were hungry, Black, whites. That's why I can get along with most people, because in growing up, we were a part of that melting pot. My father had a steakhouse in the village of where all the Jewish people had their shops. And, you know, when we go to a restaurant later in life and we said, "Oh, I'm going to get lox and bagels," our Black friends would look at us like, "Are they trying to be cute?" I mean, you know, which is smoked salmon and bagels and cream cheese. And they go, "Well, who eats like that? I mean, do you guys really eat that?" Because that's where we were raised, in that melting pot. You know, and everybody was going through their struggles and what have you. My father knew Nona's family. My mother and father knew Nona's family before I knew Nona. And how I met Nona was, we had our youth choir at our church one Sunday, and our alto singer had just left a group, and there was Nona leading the song. She said it was the first and only time she's ever led a song. And she wanted to be a school teacher. And thanks to Sarah Tash, she's in show business, you know, and I thank God for her, because she's written some wonderful songs, you know.
Wow.
But yes, so the diversity has been a part of that. And I watched my father feed people. I didn't know what the dining room, because I'm in this home that I grew up in. I restored it and came back to bring it life again. But in the dining room, Dad always had breads, canned goods. People could come. It was known that you went to Elder Dash's house if you were hungry. We had 3 freezers, meats, and all kinds of things. And yet these are people who had 13 children, mind you. So, you know, the blessings of the Lord was upon him. And, you know, Abraham means father of the nations, right? He was a true saint to his name, you know? And Elizabeth was with Martha. That was my mother's name.
Yeah.
And Samuel, Sarah, we all have biblical names, you know, but that came from my father. And during the time that I wanted to do something for the community, I spoke to a politician in New York. I was living in New York, and he said, oh, come to this meeting with me. This woman has this homeless shelter, and you could really inspire the women. Come and speak. Didn't know what I was going to talk about, but it started there. And the mission was to help homeless women with children. And that began, I began to see the struggles that women getting divorced or domestic violence, how they had to be shuttled into there, the restrictions and how serious it was. And from that, I've just been the advocate for women, you know, with children, homeless women. And it has spilled over into homeless men, you know, anyone who needs help, you know, so that's where I am. In fact, when I'm walking in New York, I used to carry like a couple pockets of change and loose, you know, just to pass out so I wouldn't have to open my pocketbook, which is say here, you know. Yeah.
Well, there's so many people who are homeless in America. It's amazing to think that we're the richest country and we have so many people who are living on the streets and under bridges and in alleys and, you know, and all of these different places. And, you know, they do need help. And those who do go into some of the shelters do appreciate people like yourself who advocate for them and their rights. And, you know, we only thing we can do is just try to lend a helping hand. So I'm so glad to know that you're doing that. And I saw that on your bio, and I felt, you know, surely there was a story behind that, because people who reach out to help somebody else, there's always a story behind that, because humans, I don't want to say they don't naturally help others, but usually if there's some reason that they are advocating and helping, there's a story behind why they're doing what they're doing.
Yes. And during my father's latter years, it was Thanksgiving, and he called me up. He said, are you giving us Thanksgiving or Christmas? That's the holidays. I would decide between the two. And sometimes I just come back for Christmas and Thanksgiving. But he called me up and he said, my father gave away turkeys to families. He would go to the supermarket, tell the managers what he was on. They all knew Dad. You know, like the woman said, oh, just because you're famous, that don't mean nothing. The Dashers were famous before you became famous. I said, oh, okay. But he called me up and he said, Sarah, I would like for you to take these turkeys, and you will know, you know, your brother will drive you. He said, but just imagine the feeling people will have when they open the door and you're standing there, what it would do for them. You know, show them that you do care. And because he knew what kind of person I was, he knew what he raised me to be. So I did that. And as a result of working with La Candelaria, which is the homeless shelter, I was on the board, and then I became the fundraiser for them. As a result of that, I was able to go around east, up on the Upper East Side, where nobody would go. I got the police captain to walk down the street with me and shake hands with all the little criminals, and they started respecting the blocks where our shelter was. I went to the supermarkets and got turkeys. We had so many turkeys, we ourselves took some home. I distributed to other people that I know. I went to Macy's and said, listen, we have these children here. I need you to send us a certain amount of toys. I got Bloomingdale's. They would have a coat drive. I made sure we got the coats, you know. So it just watching my father, how he was not afraid to talk to people. He gave me the strength to be more more outgoing and asking and praying for what he wanted, you know?
Yeah, I love that and so appreciate that. That is important, because a lot of times people reach a certain plateau and they don't go back and help those who are needing help the most. And so I so appreciate that about you. Let me see if Minister Kat has a question that she wants to ask.
Of course, of course, of course. Hi.
Hi.
Good to see you again.
It's good to be seen. It's good to be
seen. Yes. Oh my God. I just admire you so much.
Thank you.
the works that you have done is amazing. I used to work for a women's shelter in New York, the Brooklyn Community Housing and Services. But anyway, I just want to ask you a question. Have you ever lost your words on stage, and how did that make you feel? Because it happened to me in high school. So I didn't even want to sing for the rest of my life, get pushed out there, like that. Yeah, I sing now, but to just like be on that spotlight thing. But how have that happened to you, and how did you recover?
Well, I've had the ability to make up words. And at one point I panicked, and one night I could not think of the words to the song, I Can't Believe. I sang the first verse, and then I sang the first verse again for the second verse, and did all the aerobics, vocal aerobics. I've always had that issue. When we were Patti LaBelle and Bluebells, it was a song that Nancy Wilson sang, and I was leading it. Don't take your love from me. And the words were, would you take the wings from a bird so they can't fly? And one night I couldn't think of the second line, so I said it again. And then I said it the third time, and Non and Pat, at first they were sweet. Yeah, if I, then when I said it again, they said, bam! And when I got to the third part, they were like, they were looking at me like, if you say this one more time. I could not think of the words, so I kept repeating. And then I learned to make up lines as I went along, But that's, that's what you do. And if they're sweet and they sound like they belong there, nobody will ever know until it's like you have somebody like Sylvester in the audience and you go, she did that. But that's what I would do. Yes. Yeah.
That's amazing. Thank you for sharing that. I feel so good now. Thank you for that.
Yes, I'm going to try that.
So if I try that on a Sunday, Bishop, when we get back to regular worship, yes, I'm just going to make it up along the way. Y'all just say amen for me. All right.
Now, I'm not suggesting that you don't do your work, because it is important.
I know.
But I don't want to get a call from Bishop saying, okay, you've turned my choir around.
Wow. That's good. I think that is good advice, because so many people, I don't know if their brain froze or what happens, but just tell them, kind of make up something, as long as it's still in the same rhythm and syncopation, nobody will ever know. And now I think, okay, I wonder how many people have done that already and we didn't know they weren't singing the right words.
Well, let me share this with you. The very first time I saw Barbara Streisand on stage, I said, what is she doing with a music stand? She had her lyrics on the stage. And, she set a precedent, because now it's not strange for any of us who've reached a certain place in their career to set your lyrics on the stage and have them there. Some people have teleprompters. Barbara Streisand's teleprompter is straight up in the air. Unless you're on the stage, you don't see it. But her words are now, instead of having the music stand, of course, we don't play those big arenas like Girlfriend does. So, she's able to have a teleprompter. But it's normal. I don't know what it is. You can remember the melody, the inflections, but the lyrics go, Yeah.
Wow, I feel like we got a real secret today. What y'all think? That's amazing. So we don't feel bad about forgetting some of the words. Now, I thought it was interesting reading about the Trenton Mix music. So tell us a little bit about that. And you're a podcast host. Wow. So tell us about that.
Yes. Well, Trenton Makes Music happened as a result of a seminar that I gave at the college. And one of the professors, Professor Kim Pearson and Teresa Hostak, she has one of these, and she married an Indian doctor, so she has that name. They were at the seminar and they said, you gave us history to a certain point about the artists that come out of Trenton. And, Trenton was a very viable place. I mean, it was enterprising for arts. We were considered the B market. you would play New York and then the stopover in Trenton and then go on to Philadelphia. So as a result of that, we had a lot of talent come through here. And then we started digging deeper and said, there's a lot of talent that came out of Trenton. Clifford Adams from Kool & the Gang, Instant Funk. There were opera singers. We had an opera house back in the day, the Trenton Opera House. We had the Trenton Symphony. When that shut down, as a result of meeting a trustee, me along with six other people, we upstarted the New Jersey Philharmonic Orchestra back with 60 musicians. So as a result, they were watching me create all these things. So we decided that we would create a course based upon the music history of Trenton. And we did a lot of research. And I had some devastating to me simply because I played violin in the Trenton High Orchestra. You guys didn't know that, right? That I was a violinist.
Nope. No. Okay.
And well, at the same time, we were starting up with Bluebells. And I said, well, since I was in the orchestra, I just went up to the teacher and I said, I think I should be, they were taking the yearbook pictures. I said, I think I should be in that picture because I did put time in here and you all should let me take the picture. I guess he was saying this, I'm the only black girl in the orchestra. He said, yes, of course the lighting wasn't that great and we all had to wear white blouses. But guess what I discovered? At Trenton High, did not put my name in the book. You see this black girl in the school book, and I was devastated. I did not know my name wasn't in the book until I started doing this course. And this course really opened up other doors where we could bring in other artists. The school started bringing in other local artists into the college. They put me on the cover of their school magazine. And it was entered into the college competition for magazines. Well, we won over Harvard and Yale that year. And the school got an endowment for $100,000. Wow. You know, so, and I stood at the dean. You know, we go back and sometimes I'll drop in on the school. And they've been asking me to develop another program, which I'm stumped, I don't know, because I'm now writing my memoirs. So, you know, writing that, being in the house and writing songs, not doing very much. I don't know how to clean that well. And I don't know how to do laundry. My sister told me, I lived with my sister for a couple months when I had surgery on my knee. And I said, well, I did laundry at your house. She said, every time you put clothes in the washing machine, I went down there and took them out and sorted them. You don't know how to do laundry. So I'm learning all these things now, you know.
But see, that's why I said your sister keeps it real with you. I know Deacon Sylvester said you don't need that, but I believe you do in some instances. Yes. Got to have somebody who keeps it real.
Well, you know, I called her up one morning and I said, what side do you press leather on? She said, don't you dare. I was getting ready to iron on. I thought you could press leather with the iron. I thought you could take the wrinkles out. I didn't know. She was like, okay, we really need to watch her. Yes.
Wow, that's amazing. I have one more question, then I'll see if anybody on Facebook has a question before we get through tonight. Being that you all were singing during the time of the fight for civil rights and the fight for laws, protections, and equal rights and all of that, how did your group help to bring your message to the people? Or did you ever bring any messages through your music to people about what you felt about what rights and about equality and all of that that people deserved?
Well, during that time, we were kept out of the race. Like the other singers, the Supremes, they were marching with Martin, our record company kept us away from the civil rights movement. everything we learned about it, we read in the papers or watched the news. So we were very much aware, you know, because we met Rap Brown and he was trying to get us involved. And, you know, he came backstage a few times and next thing we didn't see Rap Brown anymore. You know, we met some of the Black, you know, the Panthers. And all of a sudden, we didn't see them anymore. You know, we were really getting into it. So they kept us out of it. And I think because of that, as a result of that, LaBelle started singing those type of songs. You know, I finally made it home. This, and we did Gil Scott-Heron's, you know, the revolution will not be televised. That radical part was waiting there all the time. You know, if you listen to some of the songs that we sang, some of Nona's writings, it was like a burst of freedom that came from that. And that happened around the time when we decided not to be in the same gowns and the same wigs and shoes. We were liberated, you know, through our music. So that, you know, I was very much aware, like I said, of Martin and all those people, because I think it was left up to us. We probably were giving all our little bit of money to them, you know. But they sort of swept us away, you know? So we did what we could do for the 70s in our time, you know? Yes. Very much.
How were those outfits? Let me ask you that. Now that you talk about that, how were those outfits? I mean, did you ever design any of your own? Did you say, this is what we're wearing this week? And then somebody else said, this is what we're wearing? Or was it always somebody else? How did the outfits go? Who did that? And did you enjoy those?
Well, as Patti LaBelle and the Bluebells, we were sort of radical anyway when we came out with those bell-bottom pants. Ralph Cooper, DJ, was like, no girls on the stage with pants with me. And we just brushed past and we were so nervy as the first time we were at the Apollo singing. I sold my heart to him. He said, I never seen no women in no pants, you know, men. We paid him no mind. We just went right on the stage, tore the house down and came back off the stage. So we were kind of radical, but at that time we were picking out our clothes and we would go to Learners and get the most expensive or the cheapest, best looking dresses. And they would be so unique on us because we had taste, you know, like when you see the picture of us with the three lace dresses, I think those dresses cost $10 a piece, you know, but we were able to do that. Then as we became LaBelle, we were working on our own individual styles and along comes Larry Legaspi, who started, it was really soft in the beginning. He put, you know, strips of this on me and looked at Pat and saw her motherhood and Nona's, you know, coming through the fence, you know. And he was the one who's responsible for that space age design and the feathers. And by the time we got to the Met, we had to get special bags to carry our costumes. But it was a development, you know, and then the feathers and that whole big thing. I mean, the costumes became bigger than us, but we were able to draw people. We used the law of attraction to bring it in. Yeah. And they had to listen and then they start buying, you know. Lady Marmalade has been a traditional song for us in the sense of it's been there to support us down through the years. It's been in films. It's just been everywhere. Even so that we had that other group, who was it, Pink, and who was it, Sylvester, Christine, I can never say her last name, but all those guys, they came behind us. But our song, written by Bob Krull and Kenny Nolan, has had an effect on the American life. And around March 24th, you're going to hear an announcement, and I'm not going to say any more than that. But it has been, okay. So call me when you hear it.
Definitely. Are there any other questions that we want to ask? Any other questions? Any other comments?
Nobody wants any to other say comments? Anything to
I
me.
I just feel like I'm sitting on a taping of a TV1 episode of Unsung. You know, because it's like all of these inside details, you know, it's just fascinating to hear it firsthand, not told by someone else, you know.
Yes.
Well, can't wait for the book to come out.
That's why I decided to write the book. because there's so many stories that we have, the phases that we've been through. We're the three women in the industry who've had three career changes. And we're still here. Thank God we are still here. And we've gotten to live through and see so many honors bestowed upon us. You know, Patty having a phenomenal career, you know, and Nona being the cyber woman. And I just, whatever genre I feel like singing, God has blessed me to be able to do that, you know. So we've had, you know, Patti LaBelle and the Bluebells morphed into LaBelle, and now we're solo artists. Three career changes in this lifetime. And I'm forever so grateful to God that he has kept me and sustained me. I get choked up because I'm telling you, I've had some health scares. I had blood clots in both lungs. I went into a diabetic coma, and another time I was out flatlined. So I am, when people ask me to come and speak and talk about my career or just to encourage them, you know, which resulted in me creating a statement which says, you can't get anything done discussing what has to be done with those who can't get it done in the first place. So that's my guide to stay in being structured. And my feet don't hit that ground until I'm into the word. I don't play. And I read all the interpretations, sometimes national, amplified, you know, the message. It all increases the value of my knowledge to be able to continue to do what I do. And I make no qualms about my being involved in the church. And just to have the honor bestowed upon me from ELC, it's just like the mother of the church now. I remember mothers of the church, and they were special. So thank you. Yes. Yes.
Well, I feel like Kim. I'm just like blessed. Okay. And it's so amazing that, you know, I'm sitting here with you, and we used to pretend to be you all. You understand what I'm saying? My cousins and us at home, we used to put on shirts and act like they was our long wigs and yes. You know, all kind of stuff. And we used to be in the mirror dancing around. And I'm a PK kid. And I'm also Pentecostal coming up. So my mom yes. And them secular music, oh, I bet not be singing that stuff. So we used to have in the basement and stuff and do y'all and act like, you know, it was amazing. And now to sit here today, I'm like starstruck. I mean, like when you came to the church, I was like this. Yeah. You know, as you were saying, and it was just so amazing. So I just want to say, I thank God for you. Thank you for your transparency and, you know, just being here with us tonight. It has been amazing. So I appreciate you.
Thank you so much. That means a lot to me, you know, that to because this is where I'm comfortable to tell the stories, to be truthful about them. There are some detailed stories that you all will probably be shocked to read about Sarah Dash, but I'm telling the truth because it is a end result, which is a positive result, which is why I'm sitting here tonight. You know, some people tell stories and they're still wavering and you never know if they learned any lessons. I learned my lessons. You know, I've learned my lessons and I still have a lot more to go because sometimes I'll have 10 cents and I'll give up 8, but that's not the point. Faith keeps you going, you know, it keeps you going. And when I say that, I don't literally mean money. I'm talking about of myself, you know. Sometimes I'm so tired and people will come and say, can you do this? Like the mayor, when the COVID came around, he said, Sarah, I want you, Mayor of Trenton, Bree Gussiara, I want you to be a spokesperson for this shot. We need you to encourage the people in the Black community in the city of Trenton. So he said, and Reed Gossiara is our first openly gay mayor here. And he and I have our private conversations. He said, now, listen, I need you to glam up. Okay. So, and I do, you know, and Bishop, I'll send you some of the press that they did on that. And I wore sequin mask. I showed up big old brim mink hat and, you know, And some people said to me, was that necessary? I said, yeah, got your attention. You know?
Yeah. You know, I watched it already.
Okay.
I love mink coat. You got my attention when you drug out in the mink coat. After you talk with the reporters and the mink coat, you could just see it just walking out of the room. I loved it.
Thank you. It was a Sarah Dash moment. Well, you know, and it's all, you know, this business called show, I use it as a platform to encourage, you know, and that's my purpose. Yeah. It has to help someone. You just can't see me walking in the room, taking off my mink coat and just throwing it at somebody. No, you know, it's to encourage, to really lift people up, people everywhere. I have ministers who I'm friends with. I mean, I just love people, but we need to use this, the gift that God gives us. We have to do something with it. We just can't. It's back to the 10 gifts in the Bible, right? The one who buried there.
Yeah.
Okay. But the ones who went out, you know, so it's something that we need
that
to
increase.
Yes. Increase. Yes. Yeah. Yes. So
Deacon, do you want to say anything?
I want to let Ms. Sarah Dash know that I love you from the top, bottom, and around in my heart.
Thank you.
I really do. I really appreciate the fact that you've taken time to spend with the ELC to have just a general conversation with us. It's Thank you. Women's Month. And you attended our church last year, right before COVID.
That's
God
true.
God graced us with
that. That was the last engagement I did that year.
Yes. So I truly appreciate you and just sitting, talking with you. I know we have to have our moment of conversation on the outside. Yes. It'll probably be 2 hours and a half, but that's fine. I truly, truly appreciate the fact that you're sharing your life with us and that you're giving people encouragement in life, and the really important part is that love for God that you have. I mean, it just radiates out.
Thank you.
And it's not, you know, you look at it and some people, it's like, oh, that's fake. No, not at all. Not at all. And so
thank you.
Being a preacher's child, it shows being someone that trusts God and been through certain situations in life and overcome them and still going through.
Yeah.
It's a testament. And so that's what the Christian life is about. Nobody's perfect, you know.
Nobody.
To see the laughter.
Yes.
And to see the joy and to see that you're really using the gift that God has given you to make this world a better place.
Well, thank you.
I appreciate you.
Well, thank you. You know, I failed to mention too that I'm a top lady of distinction. And our this is the organization that resulted as a result of Lady Bird Johnson. They came when she invited people to the White House. Top ladies of distinction came out of that, and she was supportive of that team. And we, our mission is education. We every year have fundraisers, and the money goes to the senior who's going to college. We buy books. We go into senior homes, and am I tired? Sometimes I am. You know, I told Bishop earlier today, I said, I'm going to take a nap. She said, you won't sleep through it, will you? I said, no, because I program my brain to be ready and to be, you know, I just saturate everything that I have to do into that moment. And I try to keep myself on a schedule. But I thank you, Sylvester. You are my brother. You are, because sometimes I would sign my emails, your sister in waiting, you know, but you have been so encouraging. And I thank you for bringing me to Bishop Abrams. I am so thankful because you guys, that Sunday when I came to speak at your church, Sylvester had been asking me to come. He found out that I was down there in my Airbnb and he jumped on it. Bishop, he jumped on that, let me tell you. And I want to thank you guys for not letting me we had dinner after church service across the street from Trump Towers. And what did I tell you? I said, I'm going to go over there and sing the Black National Anthem in the lobby and so I can get some press. And they stopped me from doing it because I was about to go across the street to go into the lobby of the Trump Hotel and sing Lift Every Voice and Sing Till Earth and Heaven Rings. Yes, I was going in there to give that, okay? Yes, I was. And they said, no, we don't think that's a good idea. I thank you for that. Because that would have been one time that you would have gotten me out of jail, probably. Yes.
Yeah, so we would have celebrated the fact that you did it, though.
Yes.
But it has truly been a blessing to have you with us and just a part of us. I did want to bring up that the last Sunday we were actually in church, you were there, you blessed us through song and through word, and it was just your spirit that we remembered as a part of that last Sunday. We have not been back in the building, we have not been back together since that time. And so, you know, you definitely blessed us on what we did not know would be our last Sunday in the sanctuary together. And so, you know, yes, it was amazing. God gave us a grand Sunday before we had to go into this virtual space. And so it is truly a memorable moment. And so we thought about it. Deacon Sylvester and I talked about it and laughed about it too. You know, that we should make Sarah Dash one of the mothers of ELC. We don't have any mothers yet, being that we're going to be 7 years in May. And so, you know, we said, okay, how wonderful would that be for Sarah to be the first mother of ELC? And I said, well, you need to make sure she knows that she is Mother Sarah now. So he told me. He wrote you and said, Mother Sarah. And so, you know, then I wrote you and said, Mother Sarah. And you said, well, I did hear about that. So, so we wanted to make sure that you knew that
I'm
you
very comfortable
to be the first mother of ELC.
Thank you.
And, you know, you have done so many things to bless so many people. And people who do great things are not without having challenges and struggles that they have to overcome. And so we're so grateful that God spared you. God knew you had more work to do, that you were still here. The enemy could not snatch you, could not take you out, could not make it where we would not experience you at this point on our journey. And all of the people who will get to read what you write, because you know last year, Bishop was on Sarah about that book.
Yes.
And so I'm waiting for the book to come out.
Yes.
And so you have a lot more to give to the people. Whatever way you choose to give it, we want you to give it. But please include ELC in some of the things that you're doing, because we definitely want to support you. And we want to be there for you when we can. And, you know, we want to see you go to the next level. Like you said, some people are able to take you to one level, then you have to move to the next group and go to the next level with them, and move to the next group and go to the next level with them. So we're glad to see you on this level. And you know, we're excited about all that God is gonna do with you, for you and through you. And so you're looking radiant, you're looking beautiful, you're looking fabulous. You're just looking a little, not quite like you looked on the video years ago, but not too far from it. And and I'm sure they can, you know, take a couple of stitches out of that outfit and let you get in it today.
Yards. Yes, I mean, and during that time I was a vegan, and I never ate meat or anything. And I got sick, and at the pills that they gave me, I was so natural. But I thank God for the fact that I can look at those things and say, Lord, how far you brought me. Look how far you brought me. And they make clothes in my size, the size that I am now. You know, So yes. Thank you for that, Lord. Yes.
Yes. And so as we get ready to sign off, I do want you to give us that theme or that thought that you gave us before. That was good. I was trying to monitor all of my screens here. I didn't get a chance to write it down, but give us that thought you gave us before, because I think that's a wonderful closing thought for those who are watching on tonight.
You can't get anything done discussing what has to be done with those who can't get it done in the first place. Discretionary.
That is a shouting statement there, honey. A shouting statement. A shouting statement. Well, you all have heard from none other than Sarah Dash herself on tonight. And we thank her and thank Deacon Sylvester, Minister Cat, and Deacon Kim for joining us as we talked with Sarah Dash. If you missed it, or if any of your friends miss it, you missed any of it, go back and watch. We will have it up for you to watch and share it on your pages. I'm asking everybody tonight to share it on your pages, because you need everybody to hear the secrets, the inner things that Sarah Dash shared with us on tonight. And I'm so glad that y'all know she's a mother at ELC. Don't try to steal her. We already have her. Right? So, again, thank you to the legend, the legendary, the phenomenal, the dynamic, awesome Sarah Dash for joining us at ELC on tonight.
And Bishop, and may I say one more thing? I want you all to pray for Mary Wilson's family. They laid her to rest yesterday. She was a very good friend of mine. We used to call ourselves the Forgotten Singers, because we both came from a group where our lead singers left us. So we used to call ourselves, but I was an advocate with her, you know, supporting groups that have fake names. And we did so many things together. And her daughter, Turkessa, and her son, they have really been going through with the grandkids. And her ex-husband has been a very nice person in the lives of the children. They always continue that. But please pray for her family, that God will strengthen them. And we just need to put a circle of prayer around them, because when you have a famous mother, you know what that can lead to. And we don't want any sibs or anything of energy that's not correct. So please pray for the family.
Yes, okay. Yes.
Thank you. We'll do so.
And remember on Sunday to join us at 11 a.m. Also, we have Palm Sunday coming up. We want you to join us for Palm Sunday. That is the last Sunday in March. And then we have a Good Friday service where we're going to have some of our ministers who are going to preach the 7 words of liberation. We're doing something a little different here at ELC. And so we're going to have 7 words of liberation. And so join us for that at 6 p.m. on Friday. And then on Sunday, we have the Resurrection Easter Sunday. That is the first Sunday in April. So we want all of you to join us for all of our upcoming events at ELC. You can tune in virtually. We are still virtual, but you can find us again on YouTube. You can find us on Roku. You can find us on Facebook, and you can find us at EmpowermentLiberationCathedral.org. Thank you again for tuning in. And as we always say, this is the year of intention. Y'all say it with me. I didn't hear somebody.
Okay.
This is the year of intention. Okay. Somebody missed it. Somebody still didn't say it. This is the year of intention. Good night, and
good night.
Blessings.
Thank you, Sarah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you guys for having me.